Hello, I'm Happy Exploit Cat, and there are a lot of reasons to come to and to explore the Nether, but the biggest thing holding a lot of people back are all of the deadly mobs that spawn exclusively around here. In fact, there are 11 mobs that spawn naturally in the Nether, only one of these is passive towards you, two of them are going to be neutral until you attack one of theirs, but the other 8 will all attack you on sight, and given that these 8 mobs are very, very scary ones that you won't fare well in if you go to hand-to-hand combat with, basically a lot of people get very frightened of the Nether and can conclude that it's not worth coming here. But here's the deal, every single one of these Nether mobs that will attack you on sight has some form of weakness you can exploit, and in today's video, I wanted to guide you through all of those so you don't have to die to the hoglins like this, or indeed to any of the other mobs that you're going to encounter here in the Nether. But we are going to start with the hoglins because they're the first, the most important, and perhaps the best food you can find here in the Nether on a stable basis. So how exactly do you kill hoglins without running into issues? Because a lot of people see them as just pork chops on legs, and if you have that attitude, you might end up dead rather than fed. So if you want to fix that, you need to realize that these are monsters which have a serious amount of health. They're also giant in terms of their hitbox, and they're also giant in terms of the damage they can deal to you when you see a big pack of them. So what do you do when you spot a hoglin charging at you? You're on low health, you don't know how you're going to survive this one. Well, the real trick with hoglins is to make up for their giant attack range and damage is you want to get a serious distance vertically between you and the hoglin. This can work with the hoglin on the high ground and you on the low ground, but I recommend that you get the high ground instead. That's right, we have now officially taken the high ground, and by being 3 blocks above the hoglin, we can avoid the attacks from it while still being able to deal damage to it ourselves. What's that, hoglin? You want me dead? Nah, can't accept that as an outcome, because we can crouch down and we can deal damage to it, indeed getting some pork chops, which we can use actually to deal with this very desperate situation we find ourselves in, just in case you are chasing them explicitly to get some food. So let's go down and let's run through this, and now look at that, we've got some cooked pork chops we can eat, although actually we got raw pork chops, but ignore that, and now we have ourselves a decent source of Nether food. Using height to your advantage is very key here in the Nether. When you are attacking a hoglin, be 3 blocks above it or be some number of blocks below it, because the big hitbox can be used to your advantage, not just in terms of height, but something else you'll notice is that it also works this way in terms of gaps. If we attack this hoglin and he comes charging after us, we can just dive through one of these gaps right here, and the hoglin cannot get through these gaps, but we can use those to attack the hoglin instead. What's that? You want to come round? You're going to have to get through these gaps, which it cannot do. So yeah, you just have to make yourself a little fortified box, and you can avoid that very easily. If we just have all 4 pillars, you know, combined, now the hoglins cannot get to me while I'm in the middle. So this is a very good defensive tactic if you're not sure what to do, and if you want to attack and be guaranteed of your results and, you know, get a good, better assessment of the situation, then I recommend being on top of one of these pillars. But yeah, pillars are going to work for you either way in this situation. Just get enough distance so that you can do this, and then jump up there and finish off the hoglin. Nice and easy, and now we get ourselves some pork chops, which again, will deal the situation of the damage you'll be dealt with while you're doing that, because piglins, like I said before, do a lot of damage, as you can see. So the second mob that you'll find spawning in the Nether that is hostile towards you on site is the baby hoglin. This is a super easy mob to take down, because all you've got to do is punch the baby hoglin once in any form, and the hoglin will run away doing the little resound, at least for a little bit, and then you just punch it again, and then it'll run away continuously until it is dead. The only reason it should come back to you is if it forgets that you attacked it, and sometimes the mob logic do be like that, but yeah, just bear in mind that the baby hoglin has less damage and can just be knocked away by attacking it anyway. So it is funny to say this, but the best defense in the case of the baby hoglin is genuinely an offense. You just have to attack it once in melee combat, and then it won't be able to come back for you, which is nice and easy. The third mob you're going to find around the Nether, particularly in Crimson Forest biomes and in the Nether Wastes, are going to be these piglins right here. Piglins can spawn with gold swords or with crossbows. Neither of them you really want attacking you. How do you prevent the piglins from attacking you head on and killing you? Well, this is a simple enough one. All you've got to do is give them some gold. If you have gold ingots or anything of any gold type, you can throw it on the ground and it'll interest them. Obviously though, if you have a decent amount of gold and you want to protect yourself from piglins preemptively, the best thing you can do is get yourself a piece of gold armor. The piglins will chase you relentlessly unless you have some gold on. The moment you have some gold on, they decide, actually, you're cool, you're one of us now, and they stop attacking you. Wearing gold armor takes piglins from hostile to neutral, which is huge by itself, but obviously both of these strategies are predicated on having a decent amount of gold to trade with some piglins or to make into armor. What happens if you don't have gold to wear or to give? Well, I'm glad you asked, because one of the biggest ways to get the piglins distracted by something other than you is getting hold of hoglins near them. Of course, this does have the potential issue of giving you two things that want to kill you, but in the ideal world, what usually happens is the piglins attack the hoglins attack the piglins, and you can get out of there scot-free if you can get past both of those groups of mobs. So what should happen when you run a group of hoglins into a group of piglins is the hoglins attack the piglins attack the hoglins, and you can make your way out nicely to the side. What is wrong with the Minecraft, like, snapshots right now. The piglins don't work in the slightest. I want that to be on record. I'm very mad. Oh, Lord. So another mob that is absolutely terrifying the first few times you want to take it down is the blaze. And although the blaze is super terrifying for doing fire damage and doing a lot of it as well from serious distances sometimes, it's worth mentioning that the easiest way to avoid a blaze's fire is just to dodge behind something. You can use netherwood, it won't catch on fire. Pro tip right there. But if you actually want to take on the blazes head on, which you need to if you want to beat Minecraft, as they are still the only source of blaze rod in the entirety of Minecraft, well, there's a few techniques you can use. If you want to attack them from a distance, so you can still jump over and dodge their attacks, you can use snowballs, because blazes will actually, they're the only mob in the game which are weakened by snowballs. Snowballs deal 2 damage to a blaze, which means it only takes 8 snowball hits, which is somewhat easy to do at enough distances. 8 snowball hits and a blaze is going to go down. So this is my easiest technique I recommend, because you can keep dodging their attacks while you do so. But if you think that's too much of a risk, or you don't want to do that for so many blazes in a row, because it requires a lot of snowballs which come from the overworld, and maybe you're doing a never only challenge, well, the second technique you can use against blazes is a very simple one. They use fire attacks, which is super deadly, but it means that when you have fire resistance on, blazes are worth nothing. So just to clarify, here are 2 blazes on fire. I have fire resistance from a potion I got from trading with piglins, and as a result, when the blazes try to attack me, they can do nothing. They can only hurt you physically by touching you, and even then it's a super small amount of damage. Their fire attacks do nothing to you, which means you can come in here and you can swipe them super simply. And the cool thing about blazes is they actually have some of the lowest health points of any major hostile in Minecraft at just 16, which means it's very easy to take one down and to get yourself a nice blaze rod and go into the fire, which I think is really great. So you can use blocks as a protection temporarily. You can use fire resistance as a permanent shield. And if you want to attack them from a range and you don't have a bow and arrow, or you want to do something a little bit more niche and different, you can use snowballs as well. All of these things are valid techniques that will allow you to take down the blaze and also use an otherwise next to useless block. Because let's be honest, snowballs are fun when you're playing multiplayer. But if you're playing solo Minecraft, snowballs are just cute and whatever else. But in, you know, the Nether, snowballs have some use against this mob right here. But the biggest thing is just have fire resistance. I've literally been ignoring blazes that have been attacking me non-stop, and it hasn't bothered me in the slightest. So while you're walking around the Nether Fortress anyway, looking for some blaze rods to beat Minecraft, you might come across some of these guys. These guys will inflict withering damage on you, which is super deadly, because not only do they hit you immediately, but also they can do this wither damage, which goes straight through armor. So no matter what armor you're wearing in Minecraft, you're at threat from these guys, and when you have that alongside some fire, it's super damaging. So the simplest solution to the withering effect, if you do have a lot of armor, but you're just worried about the withering effect finishing you off, is to always bring some milk buckets to the Nether, so that way you can drink the milk bucket, remove the withering effect, because milk buckets cure every effect in Minecraft. That's not how it works in real life, but it totally works in game, and we have to trust it. So that's the first thing you can do. But if you want to avoid their attacks altogether, the simplest thing to do is to use their height against them. Wither skeletons are 3 blocks tall, which means all you've got to do is just block up the ceiling or the floor just like this, and wither skeletons will not be able to make it through. As you can see, there is literally just a single block in the ceiling. I can still walk under here if I want to. It's not a good idea, but I can. But the wither skeletons can't get to me, which means I can attack them nice and calmly at a very slow rate from here behind the wooden planks, or in this case, the warp planks. They're not technically made of wood, but you know what? They're basically wood, right? We can all agree. But yeah, we can kill the wither skeletons from behind here at a super slow rate, but we didn't get withered once, right? So that's a nice benefit. And because the wither skeletons won't be able to jump up over, because again, they're not 2 blocks wide, they can't fit through this gap, it means you can attack them while still having full awareness of what's in front of you, or indeed behind you. Or if you really want to do something weird, you could make like, you know, this is something I do when I'm super terrified. I did a hardcore run recently. It went kind of wackily. And what I did is I made little doorways in my Nether Fortress, so I can get through very easily, but it's like a panic door that shields me from blaze rods, as well, you know, from blaze fireballs, I should say, as well as from the wither skeletons. 2 things that when they hit simultaneously will kill even the most armored of players on hardcore. So look at this, wither skeleton, you wanna come through here? You can't. And also, a blaze can't hit me while the wither skeleton's there because of this. The blaze gets hit by the fire, but obviously you can't die as a result. So the white mob that a lot of people forget can spawn in a Nether Fortress as well is, of course, the skeleton. So skeletons can spawn singularly in the Nether Fortress, or they can spawn in big groups over here in the Soul Sand Valley. And obviously I don't need to explain that when they spawn in the Soul Sand Valley, they are a pain in the neck, because honestly, you know, being trying to get after them, trying to attack them physically, while they're attacking you from a range and while you're on this super so soil, is a super frustrating thing that is easily fixed with Soul Speed 3. But if you don't have Soul Speed, so you can't can't charge towards them and just easily kill them? What is the solution to skeletons, one of Minecraft's most annoying mobs in the overworld, and one of the potentially most deadly mobs here in the Nether? So there's a nice easy solution, because if they spawn in groups, it seems like it's double the firepower, but in a way, it's kind of doing you a favor when you get more than one skeleton, because all you need to do to make the skeletons stop caring about you is to stand between them and wait for them to attack each other, or better yet, if you can't afford any hits to yourself, which is often the case, right, you get them to stand one apart just like this, so one is really close and one is not, and eventually the back one will attack the front one just like this, and what's gonna happen? All that, okay, you know what? Not what I was going for, but it technically worked out for me, right? So sometimes you'll of course get lucky and you'll die without that need, but here's something you can do when you've got a group of skeletons, two at least. You can get the skeletons to attack each other just like this, and then the skeleton will attack the offending skeleton, and you'll have a skeleton war. One of these skeletons will kill the other, and the one that isn't killed in this little bit of a fight out, we can get a third one involved too if we try hard enough actually, but the one that isn't killed in this fight out is going to all of a sudden, okay wait, look at this, we've now got one of these skeletons kill the other, then the other two in a fight, and with very little damage done to ourselves, we can heal up, we can make a little fortification, we now have two dead skeletons, we just have to kill a single one, and that single one is going to be weakened from the skeleton arrow attacks, which means two hits with a iron sword, and all of a sudden we've nailed it, and now we've got to deal with some hoglins again. Wow, how do we deal with hoglins? We make it nice and tricky for them to get past us, of course, or we stack up to three blocks. Let me show you this again. Wow, look, earlier video coming in handy, showing you why you should always have multiple blocks in your inventory, because the Nether's a scary place, and you want to avoid all the things that can kill you. Just like this. Oh, we had both strategies work at once, because the hoglins were then attack. Okay, you know what? That worked for a little bit. But yeah, piglins and hoglins, they hate each other, and hoglins can't attack you at height unless you lean right over the edge, which means you can use this to your advantage to get you some nice pork chops, which might be great to help you recover from a skeleton fight. I would say the mob that more people are terrified of in the Nether, though, has to be the ghast. This is one of Minecraft's biggest non-boss mobs. It's absolutely huge, and the moment it spots you, it starts firing explosive fireballs at you. I mean, it doesn't take a genius to be scared of these giant explosions that leave fire behind them, meaning you get explosion damage dealt to you, and even worse, you get fire afterwards, and even worse than that, if you had something you were building or you were, you know, getting around the Nether, you can be knocked into lava. It's a super terrifying combo, and although everyone knows the simple trick, how do you kill a ghast, it's even in the achievements, you just have to knock the fireball right back to it, return to sender is the achievement, and we're gonna put it off right there. Wow, look at that, we're so good at completing Minecraft achievements. But this only really works if you're at the right distance from the ghast. It only really works if there's only one ghast attacking you, and honestly, if you're chilling on a bridge that's one block wide and made of something that you know will explode, it's not the sort of thing you want to do right that moment, to risk your whole life on praying you have the right aim in tennis in Minecraft. So what do you do instead? Well, there are a few simple solutions. One, the most simple, is not to have ghast spawn at all. This is obviously a cop-out answer, but honestly, if you're in the Nether and you're scared of ghast and you can't fight them back and you're worried about your aim, all you have to do is stick to the Crimson Forest and the Warp Forest. Any biome where you have trees is going to be a biome where you do not have ghasts, which is surprisingly nice, because the spawn rates in most biomes that aren't the Soul Sand Valley is pretty low for ghasts, so you can feel pretty safe if you just avoid these biomes for the most part. Again, you can hop in there and out, but make sure you're secure every time you do it. If you want to build a house, if you want to build anything safe, make sure it's in one of those other biomes. But the other pro tip, just in case you really love one of these, is to bring some cobblestone with you to the Nether. You could obviously bring end stone, or there's a lot of blocks which have the blast resistance required, but basically soul dirt and soul sand and netherrack are all very explodable blocks. If you use TNT or beds or ghast fireballs, that explode very easily, and that's not good if you like your ground being solid. If you want your pathway or your house or your nether portal defenses to be ghast proof, just make it out of one of these hard blocks, and then they can still be hit by the explosions, but the explosions won't break any blocks. They'll just set a few on fire, and as long as it's not netherrack, the fire won't last for a very long time. It's a super nice way to make something that's kind of permanent and avoidable from ghasts. But another way, a much less conventional but much more fun way of avoiding ghasts, is actually the exact opposite technique. What if instead of using the most sturdy block in the game to avoid ghasts, we use the least sturdy block? Because if you want to avoid a fight with a ghast, like we're about to get into right here, you might think the best way is to hide yourself so you can't see the ghast, and therefore the ghast can't see you. However, all you've actually got to do to protect yourself from ghast fireballs is be behind some block where there's no direct contact between you and the ghast. Even though glass blocks are transparent and you can see through them and the ghast can see through them too, for the ghast to be able to fire fire at you, there needs to be a direct line of sight, which includes air blocks and doesn't include any glass. Which means if you have a nice glass pathway, you can see when there's a ghast around and you can avoid it just like this. As long as you place a block before the ghast finishes firing its fireball, he won't be able to fire because there's no human or player character to fire at. The simplest way to avoid a ghast is just to place blocks between you and it, which seems super counterintuitive when you're using glass, which is so easily explodable. But yeah, there's two extremes you can go for right here. One is to make everything unexplodable no matter what and just take the damage, and one is to guarantee you never have to take any damage by making nice glass pathways. So to get from our Soul Sand Valley to our Crimson Forest, we can walk all the way around that, or we can make a nice glass pathway, and the glass pathway ensures that no stray ghast will come and kill us. Also, once we get to the Crimson Forest, unless the ghast spawns in the Soul Sand Valley and transfers over, we know there are no ghasts, so there's kind of two ways to tackle this one. Be prepared for the ghasts, or just be in a biome where they don't spawn. It's the simplest solution, and it works surprisingly well. So the last mob that naturally spawns in the Nether and wants to kill you is one that I really, really, really hate dealing with. And thankfully, it only spawns here in the basalt deltas and in any piglin bastions with a mob spawner. So for the most part, my number one piece of advice would be avoid them at all costs. You don't need to kill them. You might think you need magma creams, but actually, you can trade with those from piglins. So do you need to find magma cubes? No. But if you're here in the basalt deltas anyway, and you come across a magma cube, you're going to want to know how to get rid of it in the easiest way, because these things jump insane distances and they can do insane amounts of damages to your health. But as well as having insane jump heights and the ability to split into more once you finally do kill them, something magma cubes have going for them, which is just insanely frustrating, it goes without saying, is the fact that they can attack twice per second instead of once like every other mob. This means that if you have a horde of tiny magma cubes, you might think that it's actually pretty fine to let them attack you. I mean, it's only a little bit of damage, but because that damage happens twice per second, it is seriously frustrating in cases, and it means you just need to get away from them as fast as you can. Magma cubes are something that are best not killed, in my opinion, because the splitting and the damage that can come with all of those processes is something you want to be very, very careful of. So step one is definitely to avoid any magma cubes. It might seem easy to take them down, but honestly, again, one wrong time and you're going to get hit by something, get hit by something else, and you can be dead real fast. But if you have to kill magma cubes because you're in the basalt deltas and you want to get something, but there happens to be a magma cube between you and that thing, what I recommend is finding some safe ground. Again, being knocked back by a magma cube is super brutal and you don't expect it coming like with most mobs. The second thing I'm going to recommend is to watch the jumping pattern to try and work out what it is. Obviously, the bigger the cube, the less frequent the jumps, but the higher they get. The smaller the cubes, the more they jump, but the lower they'll go. So what you want to do is as soon as they've jumped, that's when you strike, then you get back, then you strike, then you go back, and so on and so forth. You want to go in between the major jumps. Otherwise, all I can recommend is try to have a block behind you so you can't be knocked back, and then just to attack in between the swings, because again, being knocked back by a magma cube is seriously dangerous, and that's why I actually like my favorite technique is to take advantage of this and to knock back the magma cubes themselves, because all you have to do is knock them low enough down that they can't get to you and you'll be good. In this case, as you can see, the big the medium sized ones can't get up to me, so we just stack up a little bit and they can't get me. It's nice and simple. When there are big ones which can always get you, I mean, you can always stack away from them, but you won't get away from them in time. What you want to do with the big ones, if they're in between you and a thing you want and you just have to kill them for whatever reason, honestly, going underneath them is not a terrible solution because they will bounce straight over you. They jump to your position right now, not your position after you're done, so there's a little solution, I guess. Oh god, I hate these guys so much. But honestly, getting them to split and then getting some high ground away from them is the best evasive tactic, and if you have to absolutely kill them, try to line them up so they attack one by one, just like this. Again, if they're in front of each other, they'll stop each other getting to you, and it's an easy way to guarantee that you can attack them at your own pace. Magma cubes are very, very frustrating, but all you have to do is make sure that you don't get overwhelmed by them, and always make sure that you're not standing in front of a pit of lava. If I stand right here at the very edge, I am just asking for a magma cube to get past my defenses and to whack me into it. Again, it just takes one magma cube to do so, and we are dead. So yeah, you just want to make sure that's not a possibility, and that's how you do so. But yeah, magma cubes are a great source of experience because they split so many times, so that's an opportunity. And also, magma cubes are a great opportunity to get some magma creams if you really don't want to trade at piglins. But seriously, just know this is the mob you're going to underestimate the most, because all it does is bounce and jump around. It's kind of cute, right? Until it's not cute, until you're in some lava, and until you're regretting every life decision you've made that's led you until this point. So yeah, just watch out in the areas they spawn, and always watch out for behind you, because the knockback is more than you'd ever expect a cube that looks like that to be able to do. So that is all of the 8 hostile mobs that spawn in the Nether in Minecraft, and your guide to taking all of them down. These strategies should work on every difficulty, and should allow you, if you're playing hardcore, and you know, this is a thing I totally have gone through firsthand, to be able to kill all of the mobs. Obviously, there are going to be times where you make small mistakes and you have to work backwards from there, but as long as you're, you know, at full health and you're avoiding the damage whenever you can, it's okay to take a few hits of damage here and there, because that's the important thing about these guides. This is a foolproof way to take down any mob, but you're allowed to take some risks if you want to. You've just got to know when it isn't appropriate to take risks, and that's usually when you don't have very good armor, or when you're playing on hard difficulty, or a combination of those two factors. And yeah, I hope that this video helped you, and I hope that you want to go watch my attempt at beating Minecraft starting in the Nether on hardcore only. It was a lot of fun, and it was where I realized that, like, yeah, every mob needs to be taken down this way. So just in case you want to know the origins of this video, that is part of it. And the other origins is the fact that I made a video forever ago about overworld mobs and their weaknesses. So I felt it'd be fitting that for the Nether update, we do a little sequel to that. And if you want to see future videos, such as the 8 cave mobs that spawn in 1.17 and how to take them down, then you can see that by subscribing to this channel, and of course by turning on notifications. Did you know 20% of people turn on notifications, 80% of people don't, and do you want to be in the 20% or the 80? I mean, probably the 80, right? But what if I asked nicely and I literally begged, please turn on the notifications? It's how I feed the wife and kids. And yeah, there you go. Anyway, I hope you all enjoyed this video, because I'll see you all in the next one. Goodbye. You